and welcome to Worlds Tonight, the last one here from the quarterfinals and from Guangzhou, as I am joined by Froskurinn and Azael to break down what happened today. And I think, obviously, WE took it home in the end, but we have to be happy again that it was an amazing series, as we've had so many already in the quarterfinals.
I feel like we've had the best Worlds ever as far as unpredictability, as far as, you know, the level of competition between the different regions, the unique picks coming out consistently and surprising us. It's been really exciting the whole way through.
And I know it's a dead horse, but I'm going to continue to beat it one more time. I actually do think that the gap has significantly closed. Not only are we getting incredibly competitive and compelling best of fives between NA, EU, and the LPL, but also between Korea and EU.
Yeah, definitely. That's a great opening statement looking ahead to the semifinals. But let's focus in on what happened today. And I'd also like to take a moment to just to apologize again for the technical issues we suffered today, but the teams did leave it all on the Rift. It went all the way to five games, but Team WE was victorious in the end, Froskurinn. So, well, you can have a little woohoo here now for a moment.
Oh, no, I was definitely clinching for, like, at least four of those games. Game number one in particular, I was shocked that Team WE managed to win that. And then it was also the concern that I felt like it was a mis-execution from Cloud9, that they 100% should have won it. Their early game was beautiful. As we take a look at, you know, repeated dives, I think the target focus was great. But simply when it came to executing on that mid-game, that's where they fell short. And then it gave Team WE kind of this inflated sense of confidence that they could just continue to play the same style.
Yeah, I definitely agree. I do think that the early game was fantastic. I thought the Aurelion Soul made a lot of sense. When you have this pushing bot lane with the Caitlyn, you can go down there, snowball that lane, and they were able to do so. But yeah, Cloud9, in the mid-game, as you said, it kind of stalled out. It felt like it was starting to go back towards WE until they then made some mistakes. And I think both teams certainly had their chances. This game, to me, at the end, really came down just to execution, though, as there was, you know, a few major errors from Cloud9 that really kind of stopped them from taking that game.
Well, in many ways, this was also like the first game in a series where both teams are maybe a bit jittery, but it was WE that took it. And then when we go into the rest of the series, one person that was constantly dishing out the damage, I wasn't quite sure how to say that, Sneaky, in that first game as well. I think he probably realized that he could have done much more than, and it was up to C9 to pick themselves back up.
I mean, he had a pretty incredible game overall. There was a few big mistakes that people are going to focus on, you know, dying actually to the Kog'Maw. He didn't use his barrier, but also, you know, Lulu did not use ultimate or heal.
He got two shot.
Yeah, I mean, he got burst extremely fast. We didn't see a locket coming out from Context either. So certainly mistakes there, but overall he played an incredible game, you know, putting out the DPS record on a champion that people do not consider to be good in the late game anymore. And I think that Sneaky showed just how dominant the pick still can be.
And I also want to give credit to his partner in crime and Smoothie there. Smoothie kind of flies under the radar a lot. It's really tough when he's on a team with someone like Jensen, who's going to absorb so much of that spotlight and so much of the compliments there. But Smoothie, his Janna game in particular, I'm thinking about that one play bottom where Shea literally flashed into the bush, and Smoothie was smart enough to put himself in the brush knowing that it wasn't warded, so he couldn't be seen, hits a beautiful tornado, and then monsoons immediately. The amount of damage and the amount of time that he bought his team in that single play was brilliant.
It was, and it also brought on, I feel like, a monsoon of confidence for that bottom lane, because in games 2 and 3, we saw Smoothie.
Yeah, I like that.
Don't point it out. Just let it live. Let it breathe. But I feel like we're going to see this play also in this replay of the two games that followed, because C9 was unchained.
Yeah, and here's the thing is, this is where I thought that this was the kind of false confidence that Team WE had gathered from the first game. They're like, the Kog'Maw composition seems to be working. You shouldn't have won that first game, so I don't know why you're trying to run it back in game number 2. And Cloud9 were like, okay, pump the brakes. We're back in the series.
Yeah, and in game number 3 as well, I think Cloud9 played incredibly well in this bot lane. You had to give a lot of credit to Sneaky and Smoothie. They're playing into this lane that's supposed to be kind of this losing lane. And they were down in farm. They're getting pressured, but they found opportunities to actually all in and really turn the lane around. And, you know, I also have to give quite a bit of credit, because I think that Reaper in the early games, I think his drafts were fantastic. I actually felt that Cloud9 outdrafted WE in the first 4 games. And it's kind of unfortunate that almost all the attention he gets is probably going to be about this 5th game draft, which really was kind of tragic.
Definitely, it's not just you who believes that. Reaper 100% outdrafted Team WE for the majority of the series. That said, we got the Galio game. You guys got the Maokai jungle game. So yeah. I think it's pretty even, right?
It was even. And if we look at the story of the games, obviously, number 1 onto WE, landslide victories for C9. Then you think, you know, as an NA fan, Azael probably, the boys just have to lock it up now. So what in the end changed going into that game 4 and 5? Not disregarding the draft of game 5, but that game 4, where they should have taken it.
I mean, I simply think it's just a matter of execution. I think that the team that makes the fewest mistakes generally wins in League of Legends. I think WE made a few less mistakes throughout the series. I think that they had better execution when it came down to it in the team fights. And in those critical moments, really a series like this is just one or two small mistakes between winning and losing the series.
And once you make those mistakes, C9's composition is incredibly difficult to execute from behind. Mm. Having a Taric, you know, it's so hard to play that pick reactively. You have to play it proactively and have the goal to engage freely.
I definitely agree, but even in game four, I felt like they had such a better scaling composition. And even from, you know, about 10,000 gold behind, they were starting to fight back in the team fights, but obviously didn't end up winning that one. Game five, though, I do want to talk about the draft a little bit, because this one to me was, you know, a complete breakdown in the draft phase. And, you know, I'm not sure where the decisions were as far as giving over Galio, Janna, and Kog'Maw, but to me, you either have to ban away the Galio to disrupt a composition like this, or you should not have been picking Caitlyn, because they essentially drafted themselves into a corner where you have this bot lane that has to kind of smash lane, but then how are you supposed to be able to push against Gragas, who has early ganking that's so powerful, and a Galio who can roam down there and shut down anything or TP on you, you know, very early in the game as well. So they kind of painted themselves into this corner, and I felt like this would be such a different game if this is a Janna first pick for WE and a Galio Kog'Maw going over to C9, because that sets yourself up for kind of the ultimate composition where you also get Lulu, who is on the board. And I thought that that was such a failure in their draft in game five. And they gave themselves very few ways to win.
I do want to flip it to kind of the other side, because I do agree that the Galio was the issue, but I think there are, you know, viable things to pick or play into it. You know, maybe
Malzahar.
Yeah, maybe Jensen was theoretically looking at the Malzahar, but there's also just the idea that if your win condition is playing around the bottom lane, there's still other picks, you know, heavy roam champions like the Taliyah or even the Ryze, even though that hasn't been really the trend for Western teams, but just anything that could have gotten down there, that could have, you know, snowballed with Sneaky and Smoothie. I think it was the fact that they were missing that component and the Galio was there.
And I also want to turn it on its head and now look towards what WE did well in this series. And there were a couple of things. I had an interview with Mystic Frosk, and he said, I don't actually think I did that well today. I think Xie was pulling a lot of the weight for the team. But we cannot deny that Mystic is such an unstoppable force on a handful of picks in that bottom lane.
Yeah, and that's the thing. You know, Xie looked great on his two big champions, Galio and Taliyah. Who doesn't look great on Galio, though? And I appreciate that Mystic is, you know, being hard on himself and being humble, because frankly, usually he's not. But that said, this guy, statistically, in every pretty much measure number, can be in the conversation for best ADC at the tournament. His numbers are absurd.
I definitely agree that when you're looking at the tournament as a whole, you know, he's up there. But for me today, I don't think he was super impressive. I think that he certainly had very good moments. And a lot of it, I think, was kind of being enabled by the composition. When you look at a game five where he doesn't have to worry so much about positioning because he can eat shockwaves and be protected by that composition. And when you think about the winning lanes that were drafted for them when they had Caitlyn, Lulu, and they lose, you know, in the 2v2 to this Janna Tristana. So certainly there were some times where I think a better team probably would have capitalized on that and taken the series. And, you know, Mystic to me has such a high skill ceiling. Like, he's such an incredible player. And I think for them in the semifinals to have a chance, he needs to be perfect.
I feel that's what he was alluding to, because he said, well, if you think of what the better bottom lane was, you looked at how we die 2v2, then you know, right? But it's also how you are resilient and step up and still perform in those team fights. And I think when it comes to Team WE, we talked about adaptability, we talked about not making a lot of mistakes. But if you flip it around, if they see one chance, one window, one door that's open a little bit, they just go in and almost finish the game straight off that. And that is just so wonderful to see.
Yeah, they kick it in, certainly. Yeah. And that's the thing about Team WE and why they have been such a dominant team in the LPL this entire season. It's the fact that you cannot afford to make any mistakes, which in the LPL, teams make a lot of mistakes. And they just play kind of this tortoise in the hare style where, yeah, it's slow and steady. It's not super flashy. You know, sometimes they'll come out if Kondi has a great early game and Xie is playing Lucian or something and like solo kill Faker. And suddenly it's like, wow, Team W, you're a great early game team. Nah, most of the time they just kind of sit back and they just wait for you to make a mistake and then capitalize.
And the truth of the matter is, you know, you can kind of joke about, oh, LPL makes a lot of mistakes. Which region has not made a ton of mistakes this tournament? There is no team that has looked flawless. There's no team that has looked even close to flawless. Samsung, you can talk about their brilliant quarterfinals, but in groups, there was a plethora of mistakes. Longju, perfect in groups perhaps, but so many holes in the quarterfinals, right? So really, if you can perfect that style, if you can minimize your own mistakes and kind of wait for your opponents, it seems like an effective way to win right now.
It is. So let's take a look at that bracket and who we think might make the least mistakes out of those matchups. Team WE goes on to face Samsung. And when I asked the guys about it, Shiye said, I'm very confident. We're all better than Samsung. We can beat them. Froskurinn, what is it going to come down to?
It's going to come down to consistency on the day and playing up to those ceilings. I have no doubt that a team like SKT, a team like Samsung, we're always going to give the Korean teams, the LCK, the benefit of the doubt and say that they have the higher ceilings, but we really haven't seen that consistency from them. Samsung struggled in groups, came out second seed. Yes, they looked great against Longju, but that's a team that they have such a tenured history facing in the LCK. They have way more advantage or preparation time because they constantly face the team. And SKT on the other side are looking very shaky. So this is probably the closest semifinals that we've probably ever had.
Yeah, it's honestly very hard to tell, I feel, across the board, because although Samsung looked incredible, it also felt to me like Longju completely collapsed. It felt like they were not playing as themselves. You know, they were making a ton of mechanical errors. They're making a ton of, you know, decision errors as well, things that were very atypical of some of their players. You know, when you look at BDD and you talk about, oh, this is the guy that never dies, and then seeing some of the mistakes he's making to give away deaths, it does make you question a little bit just how good is Samsung. You know, are they that much better, or was Longju kind of just having a bad day? So I do think that both the matches could be close. If I'm looking just at quarterfinal form, I have to favor Samsung. And, you know, on the other side of the bracket, I feel like both RNG and SKT had a lot of mistakes. But, you know, does SKT get the benefit of the doubt for preparation any longer when in the quarterfinals they were one team fight away from losing to Misfits, right? They were depending on Misfits to make a mistake on that dive.
I mean, the name of SKT is pretty much absorbing so much blowback for them. If that was any other team, we would be so much harsher with them on the analyst desk, in the cast. But because it's SKT, the repeated mantra is, oh, it's SKT. You know, give them the benefit of the doubt. We know that they can do it. And Faker, yeah, he's playing up to that SKT standard, but the rest of his team, frankly, isn't.
I'd say Huni, I think, had great quarterfinals.
He's,
you know, I would give him
better.
That credit as well. But I certainly agree that the bot lane really was underperforming, and it's almost comical to compare Peanut of this year to Peanut of last year. It's like a, it's sad. You know, it's a shell of his former self almost, to the point.
Bengi shell?
Yeah.
They just like put him in the meat grinder and put him in the mold.
It looks worse than Bengi, you know, because he's playing a style, I think, that doesn't really fit him. And it's something that it feels like the team is either asking him to do or whatever, but it's not working out.
Well, we'll see how they can get back on that horse. And as I said, never bet against SKT. But on the other hand, Froskurinn, two LPL teams in the semifinal, it almost seems like everything's being restored, right? The pride they once had, they're playing phenomenally at moments, but there are a lot of question marks still. But here, in front of their own crowd, it's going to be in Shanghai, a packed house. It feels like it's theirs for the taking.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. This is my excited face. This is as happy as it gets. Like, I am excited for the LPL. It is cool to be like, oh, yeah, you know, this is the return of the LPL. We had the collapse of 2015, the rebuilding of 2016, and finally 2017. It's like, yep, we're back on, you know, silver, second place. We've got it. But that said, realistically, and I fundamentally believe this, if that was, you know, Misfits in this situation, or even Cloud9, I still think those semifinals are close. Like, I don't think that the gaps are actually that large. It was so close for even Fnatic versus RNG, and that was, what, a 3-1 series? And there were multiple games that Fnatic could have won that. So, yeah, I'm happy that the LPL is here, but I think it's just as much confidence in the Western teams as well.
I definitely agree, but it always feels like it's a day late and a dollar short, right? It's just that close.
It is. 7 years.
7 years in the making. We'll see. By the way, the Pick'ems are still alive. Our one guy has SKT to win the whole thing. So we'll see what happens in the semifinals. That will do it here from the quarterfinals in Guangzhou. It's been an amazing run, some amazing series, and hopefully two more next week. See you then.
Legends never die. They become a part of you. Every time you play, far-reaching greatness, relentless, you survive.
Almost goes down as well. Actually, Jennifer still fighting Shia, but that boom, bad times there. The voice of light. They light.
Oh!
Jensen snipes him down. Cena looking for a Jensen, gonna tank a few turret into an impact. He's gonna go in next. Tornado down. Mythic clashed out of the stun. But Ben, not so lucky.
Turret is perfect. He makes his way in. Jensen, he's so late. He just can't get away.
Grizzlies. Okay, 5 seconds. Get on. Ben goes down. Bottom lane falls for WE. Oh my goodness, I caught missing Jensen. Able to grab the shockwave and the assassination. Now Shea, the next to go down. Jensen with a crucial double kill. And the next is open as Cloud9 tied up. Gentlemen, we have a series.
We're back in to take one. Throw hit, make it two. Oh my god, that rocket was amazing! First blood, 9-5-7.
Heal may save his life in the pressure.
And the down is got him! Sneaky gets the kill! We're gonna go for two! Mystic, no summoners left! Sneaky outplays them! Sneaky still getting jumped up, makes his way out. Condi goes down, and the last chance saloon is closing for WE.
Game for C9, the tank line in particular to be tanky. Oh,
it's fighting on some Jensen. Condi gets out. Great shot there with the recombo. CA on a well-deserved killing spree. Smoothie falls against the Mystic, and the fight. Silence, rupture, beast. After the invulnerability wears off, Project is going to get sniped as Mystic grabs himself a double. WE poised to take this inhibitor and the game.
Okay, look, go, guys, go.
Getting chased down by 9-5-7, he's about to go mega. Flash in, first in our Project tries to defend, but he cannot get it as Mystic will find the kill. 9-5-7 pushes him all the way. The shockwave is good, but it will not be enough. Impact is trying to make it happen, but Mystic.